this. Introducing the original Blood Clot Podcast, not PS. Tuned in semantic. Special dedication all the way from New York. Boom! Yeah, man, SWOT semantic. Yeah, man, oh. Boom! Tuned in semantic. Yeah, man, oh. Big ups to the man, yeah. Tuned in semantic.
On another episode of Soothing Semantics, I am your host, Rafi Pinsky. Subscribe, like, share. How's it going, V? How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing well. Wait, Evie, right?
Evie is a vet, but Evie's my nickname.
Evie, perfect.
Close okay. Family, friends. Okay. But you're more than welcome to call me Evie.
Perfect. Okay. So we had a quick chat. You're trained with Nick.
Yep, right? For about a year.
Okay. How'd you get connected with him?
Through Jared. Actually, I write for StayFit 305. It's a health and wellness website based in Miami. It's a website where you can find out about local events that are fitness related, reviews about certain gyms, openings of new gyms, personal trainers, things like that. So I did an article on Jared on how he trains in the summer for a winter sport. And part of that training, he mentioned Nick and how he does his mental coach. And I'm like, mm-hmm. What's that? And I thought it was the hype man of rap, but it's the hype man of sports. He's just there cheering you on or you can do it. But then he's like, why don't you come out and, show you what it's all about. So I met him out there and met Nick and watched a few of the exercises that he did with Jared. And I'm like, wow, this is really cool. So I said, I'd love to do a article on you.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, perfect. So came back a few weeks later and we did some exercises and I did the interview. And I said, I know I'm not a professional athlete, but I'd love to have sessions once a week or something. He's like, he has a lot of clients that are not athletes. So I felt better about that. So I was like, okay, sign me up. So I'd never... Been going ever since.
That's awesome. If you saw the episode, I did a couple of the
Fit Light.
I think that's what they're called. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I was kind of playing around with the Fit Light. It was very cool. So I'm interested in doing something like this eventually, even if I'm not particularly trying out for a sport like Jared is, but even in your everyday life to get your mind and body connected. Make things more efficient. It sounds awesome.
Yeah, get your mind right. That's what he always says. So
yeah, for sure.
It's people don't realize. I go to the gym. I work out 6 days a week, but the brain is also a muscle. You need to keep that strong as well. So I write. I'm a writer, so it's very draining, and it could be just mentally exhausting when you're researching and writing grants. Because that's my kind of my day job. I'm a grant writer by day, so. Going to Nick once a week is kind of it's using another part of the brain that's more, it's just stimulating in another factor that doesn't include focus on words and writing. It's more just reaction time. It does require focus, but it's just different. It's my release. Almost like with writing, I'm sedentary. It's monotonous. All day, 10 hours of writing or sitting. So I go to the gym to release all that pent up energy. So it's the same thing with going to Nick. It's that release of just I need some brain games. I need some stimulation other than just writing, which he does incorporate exercises that include words. So.
Oh, really?
He knows I'm a writer. So he tries to fit, he does customize certain, with Jared, it's a different,
specific to his sport. Oh, I didn't know he does wording.
With Dustin, it's,
punching, fighting.
Punchings, certain exercises. So we, he'll do some that he'll go, oh, I know you like this because you're a writer and you'll like
this. Oh, that's, he's even better than I thought.
No, he's great. He's great. And he keeps, statistics on everybody and I'm competitive, so... It's kind of cool to say, I'm like, well, what did Dustin do on this one? Or he'll tell me, you're I don't know if he's trying to hype me up, but he's like, you're like the my best non-athlete athlete. So I'm like, all right, I'll take that.
Right? Why not?
Yeah.
Does he have a bunch of them? Or are you like one of the three and he's just...
What do you mean?
I'm totally like busting your balls in the sense where I'm making the joke as if you have there are three non-athletes, you're one of the three, and you're saying you're the best of the three.
Yeah, well, I know he trains other non-athletes.
I'm sure you're doing great.
Yeah,
either.
Yeah.
I definitely would do it because I'm not like I said I'm not particularly. I also work out 6 days a week, but I don't do any kind of track or you know serious fighting or anything. It's definitely...
It's addictive. And it just brings me back when I was younger. My mom and I used to do... She loved, like, word games and anagrams and word search. And we used to, like, race to see who would find all the words. You know, mm-hmm. I've always been kind of like a word nerd. So some of those games that Nick does kind of brings me back to those times where I was, like, I loved, you know, like, the grid, finding the numbers. So he'll has one exercise where he has the four fit lights. But the grid, an iPad in the middle with 100 numbers.
Oh, I saw. I think I saw Dustin doing that.
Right, you got to find all 100 numbers, but you also have to be putting out the lights, and you know, reaction time is it comes all into play. So,
this is probably great. It's great for anyone. I can imagine it. This is the kind of thing, and I don't think I mentioned this when I was talking to Nick. For somebody older, considerably older, I'm talking 60s, 70s. This is probably something that can slow down the process of, you know, of dementia maybe. If your brain is working, there's a lot less of a chance you'll be more forgetful, and it's like anything else. Right. So it's just it's something I want to do. So other than Nick's training, you mentioned that you do writing, right?
I do writing. So I'm a grant writer by day. I was started as a federal grant writer for college. And you don't really go to school for grant writing. You have to have some sort of, you know, skill in writing. So part of the process was writing a few, you know, grants, mock grants. And then they hired me because they felt like I had good writing skills. So you kind of like learn and develop those skills of grant writing along the way, especially for federal grant writers.
What is grant writing for people?
Grant writing, so the word grant obviously is like to grant somebody something, right? Mm-hmm. So federal government offers grants through several of their programs.
Okay, so I figured it had to do with grants. Okay,
well, it's also on the private side, but I started out on the federal side writing for a college that required programming for, let's say, you know, all their departments, so science, math, whatever. So whatever department it was, I would work with faculty members and say, what is that you need, whether it's equipment for your science labs or, you know, whatever it may be, Department of Ed, U.S. Department of Ed, Department of Homeland Security, all those federal agencies have grant funding, and they have to spend that money and allocate it down the pipeline. Mm-hmm. So I was in charge of researching those grants, writing them, and they're very technical, very daunting. So I'm grateful that I fell into that skill set, because during times of recessions or, you know, just during recessive times, my skill set is oftentimes sought out, because that's when grant funding kind of goes up. So in higher ed, it was, you know, if there was a recession, people lose their jobs, they go back to school, so enrollment rate goes up, so then now there's more need for funding to accommodate all the influx of new students. So it's like a trickle effect. So my job's always been sort of secured, because even in the worst of times is when I'm the busiest. So, but then as of 3 years ago, I got in more on the private side. I started working for the nonprofit side, and there's also grant funding there through corporate funding. They always have a nonprofit arm, you know, family foundations, private foundations, donor advised funds.
How'd you get into this?
Like 15 years ago, I got into it because I applied for a job at a college in North Central Florida. And part of the application process was just writing a few mock grants. Because you don't, I mean, it's great if you have like an English or communications degree. Okay. So part of the application process was writing. They wanted to see what your writing skills are, because you don't really get a degree in grant writing, right? So it's just, I applied. They said, you got really good grant writing skills. And from then on, professional development was key. So they'd send me to all the conferences and kind of network with other grant writers. So I had a few mentors along the way that taught me, you know, grants 101, the skill set of researching, identifying what federal funds best fit the, you know, organizations that you're working for. Mm-hmm. I've been writing way before that. Like, I have journals and diaries probably dating back. I mean, I found them when I moved recently. I think sixth grade was when I started like having diaries and journaling. So I have just stacks and stacks of journals, because I've always loved writing.
Cool. I wish I knew you could have written my essays for me when I was younger. Oh, well. No, I was actually a good writer. Spelling and writing were my best skills. I got it from my grandmother. She would read to me when I was younger and everything. So I used to beat all the nerds in spelling bees.
Yep, me too. Spelling bee champion.
Yeah, I think I still have my fourth grade trophy back in Brooklyn.
Yeah.
I remember I won with Encyclopedia. The biggest nerd in the class ran out of the room crying. I felt so good. Yeah, I would either win or I would come in second place, but I almost always won.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was the best thing. Okay, so I've never heard of this kind of career before. It's very cool. It's interesting.
Yeah, it's a very, I get that a lot. Like, I've met a grant writer before.
I didn't know they had that sort of thing. Yeah. I went to college on a grant. Well, yeah, you can call it a grant, and financial aid is a grant, right?
No, it's a grant. There's Pell Grant. There's
FAFSA. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All that, yeah. So that was good. I remember I actually made money to go to college.
Yeah.
Because the semesters were pretty cheap, so I got back a little bit of money, so it was nice. Okay, so it's very cool. And then Nick, writing. Mm-hmm. We'll go into everything a little bit more, I'm sure, but don't you have your own business? Did I misunderstand you?
Yeah, well, last year when COVID hit, they didn't furlough me, but they put me on a flex schedule. So that means 1 week on, 1 week off, you know, and I quickly said, well, this isn't gonna work as a single mom, you know, like, I need full-time work. Mm-hmm. So I started doing consulting for just on my own, just people that were, a lot of my clients I get through word of mouth. So, you know, if the word grant writer comes up, they're like, I actually know a grant writer, you know, and that's like a really rare thing, like, to know a grant writer. So then I get like calls.
You're the only grant writer I know.
There you go. So, yeah. So I just started just doing side hustles with different clients that are needing, you know, grant writing. Actually, some of my friends that were furloughed or lost their jobs, helping them with like their resumes and just picking up different work. Stay Fit, we had to shift pretty quickly because now gyms were closed. So what do we do? So I proposed the idea of, we need to perhaps write more articles about mental health, how to stay healthy at home, how to eat healthy.
That brings up, okay.
Home workouts.
You just got me going.
Yeah,
with something.
Home workouts. You know, I myself started like juicing, you know, and buying like fresh produce.
Do you think the juicing is so necessary? Don't you think it's like a way to just milk people for money? This stuff is so expensive, no? Don't you think it's kind of more of a lifestyle?
It is more of a lifestyle. And it's a lot of work.
Like, I haven't done this my whole life. And I'm sure I can be healthier. I'm quite healthy. Overall, I work out at least an hour to an hour and a half, 6 days a week. I can eat better, but I, for the most part, eat quite healthy. I don't really drink too much crap. I mostly just drink water, mm-hmm. and protein shakes are the only liquids I pretty much drink. Occasionally I have an Arizona, whatever. But the juices are awesome. Like, I'll occasionally have like a, I don't know, $5-6 juice very, very occasionally. But there are people who have them daily. I don't know, maybe you are, which is fine.
Not daily.
But they're a lot, right?
It's a lot of work, because I would buy all the vegetables raw and then make...
Oh, that's different. I'm talking about when you go and you buy these, like... But either way...
No, I bought, like a juicer.
Okay,
I'd
so if
make,
it's...
Make, like, beet, carrot juice.
Yeah, so what I'm saying is, if you're buying all the stuff and making it, then of course, then it makes sense. But for people that are spending like $8 every morning for one of them.
Oh, no.
And they're, but the thing is, they sell it. My point is, they sell it as if it's a necessity to have. You get what I'm saying? Because it's all this stuff in one. If you don't have it, you're not at your peak potential. But if it costs like $8 for every single one, I mean, if you don't care to pay for it, who cares?
Right.
Do you get where I'm going?
Yeah, yeah.
Like it's, yeah. Before these juices were a thing, fruit is still exists. Vegetables still exist. Right. It's not as convenient. You get where I'm going?
Right.
So that's why I'm asking you if you think it's such a game changer.
I mean, you have to have the time. Meal prepping in itself, I think that's where people, like, you know, initially when they buy all these, like, what do I do with it? Mm-hmm. And so I just started doing articles and blogging about how I do it and to make it more simpler. And it is, but at the end of the day, it's a lot of work. Even, you know, you buy 10 pounds of carrots and it makes like maybe 3 mason jars of juice, you know.
10 pounds of carrots?
Yeah, it was like 2 5-pound bags.
Wow.
And then some beets and ginger and all that stuff. So it was kind
of
crazy.
10 pounds of carrots makes 3 mason jars?
It made like 3 tall, like maybe, I don't think like 16-ounce jars.
Oh, okay. I thought we were talking like the small.
Yeah, like, well, yeah. But it's still a lot of work for those, you think. All those carrots, you're gonna get like a gallon.
How much does carrot juice cost to ready made? A lot of it's a lot. Can't you get that stuff? What's it called? Naked, I think. That juice, isn't that, yeah, the vegetable juice?
But I think for me, it's like therapeutic to prepare the meal prepping too.
Mm-hmm.
It was more. It's more about the process. Like I enjoyed like making it, just like.
This is definitely a Miami thing. I noticed there's like a big thing with Miami people and smoothies and just the tropical. I'm from New York.
Yeah.
So this is a very big thing. All these cafes have it. They have these smoothies and, ooh, there's a onion water cucumber drink. And everyone, it's only $21.95. Yeah. And everyone's like, ooh, I'll have it 3 times a day,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
It's just, it's part of the thing, you know? Yeah. It's healthy and whatever, you know?
Yeah. For me, it was just fun. It was fun making it. So, right. I enjoy meal prepping and doing all that stuff. So you gotta have the patience to do it. Just like challah, you know, I make challah every Thursday.
You make challah?
Yeah, I don't even have a.
Okay, I'll take whatever challah you don't. I mean, you're gonna use it all, but there's nothing like the homemade challah. Where the dough, the inside, not the outer side, but the inside of the challah,
oh, yeah,
has that texture that you know it's homemade. And everyone, any Jew, knows what I'm talking about. There's a distinct difference between the bought challah,
mm-hmm,
and the, oh my God.
Yeah. But that to me is like, I look forward to making that every week because it's very therapeutic.
Is it crispy? Know, is it kind of crispy on the outside?
Oh, yeah. I make everything bagel flavored one, and then I make
do you sell it, or you just
Nutella one, and I make these are the three most popular ones, then the churro one, which is cinnamon sugar.
Yeah, that sounds amazing. I'm kind of I would like to try the challah at some point. That'd be awesome. Yeah. Okay, so you're also very into cooking, it looks like.
No,
sounds like
baking.
Okay,
I like sweets. I have a sweet tooth, hence why I go to the gym all the time, because I'm not gonna give it up. So I have my cheat day where I can, you know,
yeah,
load up on carbs and sweets.
for sure. I'm not a big sweets guy. I'm just much more of like a heavy food guy, carbs. Like I love pasta.
Yeah,
I don't eat it too much anymore. I used to eat it heavily, but like, damn, I love a good like penne vodka. Anything fettuccine. I love pasta. I love cheese and I love pasta. I can eat it all day. It's crazy. It's not easy as a bodybuilder to make a lot of money. It's a very small percentage that actually win those awards and make it far into the bodybuilding space. It's very, very competitive and very, you know. But what I do notice that's a lot more common is that there are people who are doing very well financially, but when it comes to their physical health, they don't take much time and they don't put much effort into making sure that they look good and feel good. And it's interesting. And I think a lot of them feel like I'll speak for men, if they have a nice amount of money, for instance, the fitness is just a secondary thing. It's just a side thing. It's not that important. I was talking to somebody who was telling me that working out now isn't such a priority because he's married. And not to throw him under the bus, he knows who he is if he's listening to this. But the thing I don't understand is why somebody, when they're single, they'll put all this time and effort into working out. But when they're married, they go, oh, well, now I'm married. The person loves me. They're stuck with me. Now I can just kind of forget about it and say, fuck the whole thing. Mm-hmm. If anything, and I don't mean this to, I'm not saying this to sound all like cute. If you are marrying somebody and they are giving you their time and their resources and their attention and vice versa, shouldn't you, if anything, want to work out more? Do you understand what I'm saying? It's just a skewed, we're really delving into this, but it gets me thinking.
I think it has a lot to do with, you have to do it for yourself. So I've always.
Oh, for sure.
I've always been, since probably like 18, 19, I really got into health and fitness. Mm-hmm. You know, and obviously when I got engaged, I'm like, oh, I got to lose those 10 pounds. And then I really got, you know, focused. And there was a guy I was working with who had lost a ton of weight. I'm like, how did you lose your weight? And he says, well, I'm working with a trainer at the gym, mm-hmm. but he's also helping me learn how to eat better. And women, and men too, but in general, I'm speaking from my personal experience, the word diet already creates a barrier in your mind. It's psychological. So
a lifestyle, you're saying.
It's right. So he's like, this is not a diet. He's changing the way I eat. And it's going to change the way you eat. I'm going to share it with you so that way you don't have to spend all this money. I was young. You know, I was
on juices? You're saying I'm not going to have to spend money on juices?
Well, on the nutritional plan that his trainer had him on.
Okay.
And so he shared it with me. And it was just basic things like just replacing one thing with another, you know, instead of, you know, with tuna, instead of like in the beginning, like don't put like so much mayonnaise in it. Maybe put a little mustard, some relish, you know, instead of like these heavy, thick dressings, put a little bit of balsamic vinegar, or mm-hmm. eat brown rice instead of white rice. You know, all these different things that little by little I started changing, and it just became a way of life.
You get used to them.
You get used to it.
It's funny how there are certain things I really don't want to give up permanently, but the more you do it, the easier it becomes. So, for instance, I have Häagen-Dazs ice cream in my freezer. Love it. I could eat a whole tub of it straight, no problem.
Me too.
Yeah, most people can, right? You can go through a whole thing. But in my mind, I've gotten used to having a couple of spoons, even if it's every day. I usually do not have ice cream every day. I have some on the weekend, if I do, whatever. But there'll be some days where I'll have a few spoonfuls consecutively. But I'm not going to sit there and eat a whole tub. So have I done it? Yes. I'm sure we all have.
Yeah.
But I'm quite good at it. I'm definitely not.
I take those little dishes, you know, those little dipping dishes they give you at the restaurant, like with your like ketchup, or like they're like this big.
Uh-huh.
So that's what I put it in. So in
oh,
my
you're
mind
really
like,
good. Oh, you're good. That's very
portion
disciplined.
Control.
That's
so
awesome.
I feel satisfied, like, all right, I had my ice cream.
That's awesome. Yeah, it's you also appreciate it more when you don't. It's like anything when you ration it and you're more disciplined about it, when you get to have it, when you allow yourself that pleasure, that guilty pleasure, then you are not guilty pleasure. It's so much better. You know what I mean? You have ice cream twice a day and you're just shoveling it down your throat versus having it on occasion. When you have it, it's so much more blissful. So, yeah, they're definitely just
yeah,
having
so taking
this
the word diet out was really key because I had mm-hmm. my cousins, like, I'm on a diet, and they're right from the get go, they already have a negative mindset. It's like they're in like
it's so true
they're in food jail.
It's so true. People
you
with
know?
Yeah, 100%.
So yeah, and I, with my daughter, I've never used the word diet in the house. I said, you know, if you eat more than you should have, then you move more. Just move. Mm-hmm. You know, go swimming. She plays volleyball, so she's pretty active anyway. But you know, body image, especially with having a daughter, especially in today's age. In today's times, it's all about image, right? They have this thwarted image of what the female body should look like. I think it's evolved a bit over the years now with more acceptance with full figures, you know, and just body positive.
Yeah, I think they're a little, I think the Hollywood's a little crazy with like Victoria's Secret models. They should. I think they're a little bit too skinny. It's a little unhealthy. I don't know why that's. I don't know. Listen, to each their own. That's what people. But it's a little bit. It's very unhealthy that the women that are considered to be like the most beautiful women are. They're literally this big.
Yeah.
It's a very unhealthy message to send to an entire society.
It is.
That's my feeling. I think a lot of guys agree with that too. It's interesting how that became the norm, which I definitely don't think it should be. But I like what you're talking about with diet, because I was having this debate with a friend of mine like 2 years ago, and he always goes on these diets. He goes on these diets, he runs a lot, he tracks his running on the treadmill, loses a bunch of weight, and then he just gains it back. And I'm like, bro, you can't do this in increments or in spurts. You have to do it all the time. It has to be a lifestyle.
Right.
Because you're going to burn yourself out. You hate doing it. You're going to do it for 3 months. Then you can't wait to have that burger and fries and whatever. And then you're back to the same bullshit. So you have to make it a lifestyle. He's like, what do you mean? He was like disagreeing with me. He's like, a diet is hot. I'm like, dude, how are you supposed to sustain this long term? So then he ended up agreeing with me because it was common sense. And that's why whenever someone says I'm going on a diet, I look in my head. If I know them, I'll call them out on it right away. Even if I don't know them, I'll call them out on it, honestly.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it doesn't make any sense. And I think that's... It could be a strategy for some of these businesses too, like Atkins and whatever, because they know that the person may come right back. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Meaning there, it's like a never-ending cycle.
Yeah.
The same way they do it with like these 90-day workouts. I love that stuff. Like I did P90X. You've heard of it?
Yeah. Yeah.
It was good.
Yeah.
But it sells you a message. Truth is, I don't think Tony Horton. I don't think the guy who created it. Didn't disclose that 90 days isn't necessarily enough. It's definitely going to make a difference. Those 90 days can be very effective, but if you're very out of shape, 90 days is not going to put you where you need to be. 90 days is that's why I don't like these things so much, because it's very misleading. If you're already in pretty good shape and you just need to lose 10-15 pounds, P90X is fantastic. But if you're 80 pounds overweight, P90X, more like P300X, P360X.
Yeah.
You know, and that's with less food and this and that. So sometimes they take things at face value and they shouldn't. It's just interesting.
Yeah, and I think with those types of, they're great, like you said, if you want to shred or you want to maybe, you know, your body gets kind of plateaus. Like I have to switch up my workouts. I get bored easily, so I don't do like the same workout every day.
Are you bored?
So bored right now? No.
I was being sarcastic. Okay.
No, I mean like workout routine. The same thing over and over again. Like one day I'll do like a HIIT workout. The next day is just like strength and conditioning or a Tabata style. I'll do a class.
Tabata style? What is that?
Tabata is like 20 seconds and then with 10 second breaks in between each exercise. And there's like 4 sets, so then you do it like for 20 seconds straight. And it's usually high impact, and then you rest for 10 seconds, and you do it again for 20 seconds, and you do it, yeah.
Yeah, because usually when I don't do a lot of cardio. Sometimes I'll do jump roping. I mainly do weights. So I'll take, depending on the weight, I'll do like 30 seconds if it's not very heavy. And then if it's heavier, I'll take a bit of a longer break. But it's... Yeah, no, I do 2 muscle groups a day, and I do each muscle group twice a week. So I do Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, then I do it again Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Do you get what I'm saying?
Right.
Mm-hmm. And that's what works best for me. And then I do the first half of the week heavier weight, lower reps, and the second half lower weight, higher reps. So this way it works on the growth of the size of the muscle, but also the strength, and it kind of gives me that a bit of a relaxation time. If I'm going very heavy in the beginning, I want to kind of relax it a bit towards the end of the week. So then for the next coming week, I'm a little more prepared for the heavy weight again. I mean, I've done my research, and this is just what works best for me.
Awesome. Yep.
I don't do enough cardio, though. That's the thing.
Yeah, I don't do as much cardio as more of, the body weight or I've incorporated my own, like, especially last year when gyms were closed, I kind of like kept buying weights, heavier and heavier weights. So I started kind of incorporating strength training at home, kettlebells, free weights. And I could definitely see a change.
Mm-hmm. It's mostly body weight. Do you do any like squats with like barbells and or anything or no?
Not really. Not at the gym. I kind of like just do classes, or I'll do some of the Nautilus machines. I love the stair climber right now.
Stairmaster?
Like, yeah, but it's like the old like the one that's just, it's not the glider one. It's not the elliptical. It's like a legit Stairmaster.
Sorry. Legit stair. We're not talking about the original Stairmaster.
I guess it is. I don't know.
The one with the actual stairs,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
That one's good. That one's intense.
I never got into that. So now, recently, I see more and more of them in the gym. So mm-hmm. I was like, let me try it.
Yeah, no, they're very good.
You burn quite a bit of yeah.
Yeah, if you, works. That's very good for you. If you stay on that long enough and you're at a fast enough speed, you sweat buckets from that thing.
Yeah.
What for me works fantastically. Is squatting heavy enough weight, I sweat like a monster, just dripping sweat, because you're working out the biggest muscles in the body,
right.
You're putting so much strain and you know, pressure on them, your body's like, holy shit, you know what I mean?
I think those are my favorites, like, you know, the deadlifts and all those types that work out the mm-hmm. glutes and
quads,
the
hamstrings,
quads
all that.
And hamstrings and
yeah, my butt looks great after it's all said and done.
Plie squats, sumo squats, all those squats. Yeah,
it's so good.
Yeah,
it's just yeah, it's funny how men tend to prefer working out the upper body. I mean, we don't have to explain it; it's perfectly understandable. But like, women tend to want to work out the lower half, men want to work out the upper half, and sometimes they tend to like neglect the other side. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, you have a lot of guys who have, like, stick legs, and you have women who have their torso and upward isn't as formed or shaped, but, the bottom half is their big focus. It's just interesting how that
works.
And I
think it's preference, too, because I want more tone on the upper body, but not, like...
Like size or muscle.
Right. I think, for me, for myself, I prefer more of just a more toned, softer look. Versus just kind of like bulky, you know.
100%. The truth is, whether you're doing that for you or not, most guys have that preference. I know I have that preference. Like, I respect women that are very muscular.
Oh,
and
absolutely.
I definitely respect it. I say, listen, credit to you. You're putting the work in. That's what you want. Good for you. It takes dedication. There's a lot of guys who don't do that. But as far as like what I find attractive, I definitely don't. I think most guys aren't attracted to women who are like overly muscular. It's not a, you know, I commend it. It's great, but it's not doesn't look very feminine. So,
I mean, at the end of the day, it kind of goes back to the mind thing. So mm-hmm. if I don't work out, I don't feel good. I don't sleep as good.
Without a doubt.
I don't, you know, it's a mood enhancer. I could be in a really bad mood and go and the endorphins kick in from the workout and the sweat and I just feel better.
There's
and it could be
like
at like all hours. My friend's like, you're insane. Like, it's 10:30 at night and you just drove 3 hours from Orlando and now you're going to go work out. And I'm like, I think it's a little bit of my compulsive behavior too and personality. It's like, I'm kind of like, if I don't work out today, something's going to go wrong. I don't know. Like, the universe will be off or something. So I do it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's more to help also with everything, every other aspect of the mind, body, you know, just it's all in one. It's all connected. So at the end of the day, exercise should be not only to work on yourself aesthetically, but I think it's more for me anyway. It's more inner. It's all about the
I think for sure it's. I'm just trying to gather my thoughts. It's definitely a collection of outer and inner. There's nothing better than just achieving, for me, just achieving the next goal. You know, even if you're kind of happy with where you are and you're, you know, as a guy, as a person who likes to lift weights, you kind of have these goals you want to achieve, which is very exciting. Because there are other aspects of my life where I want to achieve things. But I love that I have my own goals in the gym too, aside from anything else. So this week I'm lifting X amount of weight. In the next couple of weeks, I want to be lifting this amount of weight. You know, and there's when you finally achieve it, it's phenomenal. You rack the barbell back on the thing after a bench press. You get off of the bar and you get off of the bench and you're like, you know, it's there's not, and you just see everyone around you, and there's a couple of people next to you lifting like half the weight, and you just, I leave the gym and I'm like, I am the man, you know what I mean? And it's amazing because you feel like the rest of the day you're just gonna kill the day, you know? And people don't have that and they miss out on it. You go early in the day, you finish the workout, you feel good, you look good, you go have a good meal. I think for a lot of people it's just tough because they're not at all near where they want to be. So for like you and I, we're both in good shape, you know, like we're both taking it seriously, we both do it, so it's easier to maintain it. But if you or I were both out of shape and we like just stepped in, it's hard because you have to break that barrier into, you get what I'm saying, that flow state. It's hard for people. That's why I think where a lot of people, they can't get past that barrier, especially if they're a lot older. So let's say you're 40 and this is the first time you've ever stepped foot in a real gym, or you've the first time you've really taken fitness seriously. It's crazy to think that there are people who've waited half their life to start taking fitness seriously, but there are people like that.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I started at 15, so I have, you know, I have experience with it, but there are people who start a lot later. It's hard. You know people, I'm sure you do, because you're in that kind of...
Yeah, family and some friends.
Like, they start much later in life.
Honey, you're so disciplined. And I don't know how to respond to that other than, because I just see it very...
You've been doing it for a while.
Black
already.
And white. Like, it's just like, do it or don't do it. Like, just do it. And it's not as easy for them. And I have to kind of like, you know...
They also hate it. See, like, for them, they feel like it's like a chore. They have to... Oh, listen, I don't want to.
There's days that I go and I'm like, I do not want to be here. I'd rather be home eating Haagen Dazs.
Leg day. Leg day, I always, when I'm done with it, I feel like $1 million. Some of the like the lighter workouts, but when I'm squatting a lot of weight, I'm like, fuck, this stuff sucks. Because it really takes a toll on you, especially the next couple of days. Your legs kill. Like I did legs yesterday. My legs are definitely sore now, but tomorrow... two days afterwards, you know how it is.
Brutal.
Oh my god, I'm gonna try to get out of bed and I'm gonna feel like an old man.
Yeah,
I mean, it's better. I've been working out legs for a while now, so even when they get really sore, your body gets used to it. You know, when you miss like 2 weeks and then you go back to it, that's when your legs are done.
Yeah,
but your body starts to adapt, so it's not going to be too bad. But there are some workouts that I definitely look forward to,
and there's days where you just, you know, okay, that wasn't, I didn't, it wasn't my best.
As much as I should have done, right.
But you did it, and you went, and at least you did it.
Right.
And that's what I kind of, like, tell myself.
Without
a
question.
Like, you already go in knowing, like, this, I'm not really into this. You try, but you really didn't put your all into it. So there's definitely days like that. I just try to motivate my friends that are struggling, and, you know, a lot of it is here. And that's the thing. It's all... You know, try to incorporate yoga and meditation, and especially during COVID last year, people were home. So then it's very easy to fall further into that rabbit hole of, you know, there was memes out there like, you know, going to the fridge every 5 seconds because you're bored, you're home, so you're gonna eat more. There was that whole thing where I kind of like, this is great because I was never home. I was always working, and.
I get that. You mentioned that. Sorry to interject. You mentioned you can be pretty compulsive. So when you're home and you have nothing to do you just run around the living room?
No, I have my yoga mat and I...
We were just talking... Oh, I made the joke about the living room.
Oh, no. Actually, before COVID, I was doing home workouts because I work such crazy hours. Sometimes I didn't want to go to the gym. I'd come home and there was a girl I had found years ago, probably 2-3 years ago, that... has a YouTube channel and was doing free workouts. She'd post a new video every morning, and I liked her because she switched it up every day. So I was doing that way before COVID hit. So I just ramped that up when we were all in quarantine. So that's when I started building like my own little home gym at home, because she was kind of becoming more popular because there were more people staying at home and trying to find ways to stay fit. And she just to me, she helped me stay motivated, and that was my workout for the day. She ranges from like a 60-minute, 45-minute, 30-minute, whatever you know, timed workout she had for that day. I made sure I did it every day, and so it was. That's a lot of the struggle with people. Like, the home is my sanctuary. I don't want to work out at home. But if you have nowhere else to go, or go outside, ride your bike or whatever mm-hmm, it mm-hmm. is, but you have to get it in somehow.
100%.
And so that I wrote that in the hopes of, like, you know, maybe people can look towards. And then that whole boom started with these gyms. Like, they had to figure out a way to make money. So then they started doing live at-home workouts. Live feeds, you know, like,
and it went pretty well for. I'm
and it
sure,
did. A lot of them became very, yeah, successful with those.
Peloton became huge over COVID.
Exactly. So a lot of things that evolved that normally probably wouldn't have evolved if COVID hadn't happened. So
it
alleviated more time for me, like I said, to maybe, you know, like, start my business, write more creatively, and that's when I started blogging because mm-hmm. I wanted to, you know, I had an idea for a book years ago, and just kind of. Kids and life just kind of kept getting in the way, and probably my infamy for procrastination, like, I always just never had time to write the book and finish mm-hmm. it. I have like a couple pages here, a couple pages there, and so now I found myself, you know, I'm at home now, and for me, being an introvert, it was like a dream, like, to be home and not going out networking all the time, even though it was part of my job, but that's what it was my job. So
there are people who definitely love that aspect, who love that COVID kind of brought everyone into that more introverted.
I know. I actually, like, relished in it. I loved it. I loved being at home, not doing a 2-hour commute, not stuck in traffic, not just
relaxing at home in like your comfy slippers and just like relaxing on your couch.
Yeah. You know, I bonded. Yeah. Getting closer with my kids, because when you're working 10, 12, 13 hour days, coming home 10, 11 o'clock at night, you know, it wasn't until COVID hit that I was really like, wow.
My you say 2-hour commute, you mean an hour in each way, right?
Well, it was an hour. I live in Broward, so North Broward, so I worked in Miami. So, you know, one accident or a rain shower, that's it. You're on the 826 for like the rest of the morning. You might as well just kick back and listen to your Audible, because you're not going to be at work anytime soon.
Yeah.
So that I didn't miss at all. And I was able, and as a writer, like, I really didn't need to be in an office environment. And it actually was more distracting mm-hmm. because you get interruptions throughout the day. And especially when with federal grants and certain grants are very technical and they're deadline driven. So it's mm-hmm. due at 5 o'clock. If you don't click that button at 5 o'clock, that's it. You're disqualified. So all these months of work and writing and researching is down the drain. So when you're getting interruptions all the time, and that's not the way, I have a certain way of a system when I'm working. AirPods in, certain music, and then I write. And that's just the way I can't be, you know, interrupted, or I like to be alone, and I share an office with somebody, and, you know, it wasn't conducive. But, you know, some organizations felt like the body there was more important, and... You know, so it worked out for me, especially in that sense, because I was able to focus more on my writing and then open up a little bit more on my personal creative writing through like my blogging on Medium and, you know, doing articles for Stay Fit and just, you know, working on my book. So I actually like got more and more into my book. Hopefully I can finish it. My goal is by the end of the year. That's it.
That's awesome. So. Make sure I definitely... want to check it out before you put it out everywhere. You plan on having it on Amazon and everywhere else?
I think, I don't want to talk ahead of myself.
Go big or go home, maybe.
I was thinking about either self-publishing it but now I have somebody that has a publishing company that may be interested in publishing it. And because of concept, she's really intrigued awesome. By it. So she feels like self-publishing it wouldn't bring it to how she wants to bring it forth. It's just a semi-autobiography. It's about my life experiences, but it's has a twist in the sense that it's I don't know if you ever heard of sleep paralysis, but I've been having, I've suffered from sleep paralysis since I was like 5 or 6 years old.
How often? How common? How often is this?
Now it's not as common because I've learned over the years to kind of...
You're talking about the sleep paralysis in the sense where you can't, when you wake up, while you're sleeping, you feel like you can't move.
It's the inability to move either in the process of falling asleep or in the process of waking up.
You have this often? Still?
Yeah, I think like my first memory of it, I was like 5 or 6.
Oh, I mean, I've had it plenty of times.
But over the years, yeah, it was just...
Yeah, what's crazy is that as I got older, I started to realize that I'm having it. When I was younger, I would have it and I would forget. And every time I would have it, I wouldn't really realize what's going on. As I got older, for some reason, my brain started to get to understand what was happening. I don't know if this is, maybe this happens to you too. And now if it ever happens, which is almost never, I realize, oh, I'm having that. This is happening right now. And I start fighting it. Like I start like forcing my body to move. Mm-hmm. And I can't remember if it's ever worked. I feel like it has. But it's all in your mind anyway. Like, I don't think you're actually awake for it, are you?
I mean...
Or I've also had... whenever I have a scary...
It's... There's a big controversy between, like, the scientific world and the spiritual world on sleep paralysis, right? So the scientific world saying, no, it's like, it's part of your REM sleep, and it's your body trying to wake up when you're in REM. And it's not allowing you to move and wake up during your dream. Mm-hmm. Or that part of your REM sleep.
Mm-hmm.
But in the spiritual world, they're saying, because a lot of people experience certain things while they're in this lucid dreaming. And I've experienced it where it's harrowing, like it's terrifying. It's not only the process that you can't wake up, but you're also having a nightmare and you're actually consciously awake and you could see, but you're not, eyes aren't open.
I've gotten this, but you know what happens? I'm like, I can say this because it's true. When I have scary dreams, which I occasionally still get, I go into fight mode. It's weird. But like when I have I had one a few months ago where I was in some random dark place and there were like wolves or something like that. And they started running at me and I was just like, all right, let's do this. And it's happened a bunch of times. Like I was a little scared and then I like psyched myself into it and I was like, okay, whatever the hell this is, let's do this. And then the dream just ended and I woke up and I was like, nice.
Yeah.
I was like, that's cool, you know? And I didn't fully remember what happened, but I just remembered that there was something scary and I decided to deal with it.
Right.
And I just decided to translate it as that as you can. Yeah. I was like, you're, you know, like it made me feel good. I was like, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So I mean, part of my book is like real life experience mixed in with those dreams, but I don't want to, some are going to be very obvious which ones are the dreams, but some aren't. Cause mm-hmm. you know, so I don't know if I've had dreams where I've woken up, I'm like that could probably be a movie or something. Like that was so crazy. Like it had a plot, like it had
details.
A beginning and end, and I would write it down because I was like, that was insane. So, but the reader, from a reader's perspective, I don't want them to know which is which. Mm-hmm. And that's where the whole concept of, well, that'd be cool because then maybe people would ask, like, in that part of the book, like, was that real or was that the dream? And then, I don't know, that's up to you to figure out. Like, I don't want to reveal that. So, but years ago, that didn't have a term. So I never really talked about it because I was like, I felt like I was a freak. Like, what is this? Like, I would literally pull myself out of it, but physically, you're like jerking out of bed, your heart is racing, you're physically tired. I mean, because you're really trying to move. I mean, you're shaking.
You probably didn't have your smoothie. You probably missed out on your smoothie.
No, I probably didn't have my smoothie. That was probably it. But, yeah. And there was a documentary, like, 5 years ago that came out on Netflix. And it, I got emotional because I was like, wow, there's a lot more people out there that suffer from this than I thought. And so, yeah. So now I've openly talked about it. And I've actually, you know, when I was in school, I wrote a paper on it. And it was like a peer discussion afterwards and all my classmates read it. And like the next day I had like all these messages from them, like, I'm so glad you wrote this. Like I suffer from this too. And I don't know, it was like really cool because it brought out like that, you know, more and more people do suffer from it. And there's a way to control it. Like I can control it. Like I said, if I'm very sleep exhaustion, narcolepsy, like there's certain scientific diagnoses that may trigger it.
Mm-hmm.
So, but if I feel myself that I'm falling into that, like you said, I fight it, and I'll wake up and I'll purposely like get up, walk around. I won't go to sleep. I'll do something else.
Interesting.
And then I'll try to go back to sleep.
That's so amazing. The brain is, that's why it's.
But in the spirit, like people in the religious world, because a lot of people do see like demons, creatures.
They put meaning behind it.
They see things that are like not. And I have felt like, you know, bad presence. I've heard voices. I've heard people walking.
In your dreams or outside of your dreams?
No, I mean, I'm awake. It's hard to explain because it's like, yeah, you can't move and you're not, you know.
I think these dreams have meaning. I don't know if like, I don't want to sound crazy, but I feel like there's, if it doesn't necessarily mean that thing's going to happen, but it could mean that there's something in your mind. Like, you know, I decided to determine these dreams where something's scary and I fight it as I'm a resilient person and I can handle this. So if something scary is about to happen, that's what I decide to take. It's up to, for my interpretation. I can go and meet with some psychic who can make some claim that I probably won't believe anyway. So I'd rather just to make that determination for myself. Who knows what it means? Bunch of like scary things about to attack me and I just woke up right afterward.
Yeah.
Maybe something will try to attack me at some point, whether it's physical or mental, and I have to overcome it psychologically. That's what I took from it. And I every time I got out of it alive, I didn't run away in the dream. So I took that as, okay, I'm resilient, I can handle it. That's what I took from it.
Yeah. I mean, I've accepted it and I'm not as afraid of it anymore. Like I had it recently. I think I was just I think it was brought on by exhaustion, really, but
very possibly.
Yeah, so I just you accidentally out like on
you ever
the
watch the movie Step Brothers?
Yes.
One so of you my accidentally favorites. Put like your purse in the oven?
Yeah.
No. Oh, it kills on fire.
No. I don't know where you learned it, but I'm still sore.
Well, there's lots more with that.
My God.
No.
What happened?
Oh, my God.
Maybe Dale left the back door open and raccoons got in.
Oh, my God.
Nancy, is this your purse in the freezer?
Yes. It's Brennan. He sleepwalks and he always puts my purse in the freezer.
Dale sleepwalks, too.
No. What the hell is this doing here? I know I put a pizza in at 400. What's my Chanel bag doing in the oven? You know, your daughter comes down. Mommy, what? Yeah. What are you doing? nothing. I just you just put it back on the chair where you had it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, but that's kind of like the premise of it. I think more and more people talk about it more. Yeah, I think Billie Eilish even one of her songs when we all fall asleep, where do we go? That song
that's about
wrote,
it
it's about it she suffers from it, and so it's interesting. A lot of people like create a lot of their creative side comes from those experiences. I mean, I'm incorporating mine in my book because it you know, the first time I ever experienced was it was a nightmare, but it was about my mom.
Mm-hmm.
So where I could, you know, in my dream I see her and I walk up to her and then she's like, only you could see me now. That's the only thing she said in my dream. But I
sounds eerie. That sounds
it was kinda very eerie. I tried to wake up and I couldn't.
That's creepy.
But so for years, I carried that dream with me. I was very close to my mom, but I lost her when I was 20. And I immediately felt that guilt. Like, see, I brought that on because.
Yeah, that sounds very.
It's just very.
Ominous.
Yeah, very ominous.
Only
you can see me now.
Wow, that's trippy.
So as a kid, I didn't really understand it, but I feared it, and I feared something would happen to my mom. That's just the way my
all I'm saying
I processed
is,
it.
If you decide to create a film about these things, and I can be an actor, no, I honestly would love to do acting. I'm not interested in moving to California and living in a trailer, but I think I have a knack for it. I could definitely do action film. Because of my military experience, I love doing different impressions. Like I can do different impressions from different countries. I would love to do voiceover.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have anything
in that mind. was my dream. Is like I wasn't the athletic type. You know, I did dance for about eight to ten years, ballet. You know, that kind of stuff growing up. But there's pictures of me like spoon on an ottoman, like everybody come around doing a concert, be here at 7, you know. That's so hilarious. My family members would come out and I sing, I dance, I would do the whole thing. I would act out, like, make, you know, my friends come over, like we'd act out like certain movies that we were watching, like The Outsiders were like one of our favorite mm-hmm. movies at the time. We would just say, okay, you're gonna play Cherry, I'm gonna play, and then we're gonna just reenact all the scenes.
That's great.
So
yeah, I liked charades when I was younger. That was fun. That was always good. I would get frustrated when people just couldn't get the damn reference, because I couldn't, and I was like dying to speak it.
Yeah.
But you can't do that, and I was like, yeah. And they just, everyone's like, but charades are fun, right? Yeah. So Evie, I'm a little bit
short on time.
So, I hope this was almost an hour 58 minutes.
Oh wow.
So we definitely got a lot. We discussed a lot.
Yeah.
Hopefully we'll have you on again sometime in the future. If you'd be open to it, we can discuss. We didn't get into discussing the whole conversion thing. So,
oh yeah.
I have to take care of a few things today. But thank you so much. Thank you so much for coming. I had a really nice time. And guys, make sure again to like, subscribe, share. I'm going to drop all your social media, so yeah, any websites work-wise, so people can connect with you. And as always, ladies and gentlemen, tune in every Sunday at 9 a.m. Eastern. It's also on Spotify, Google Podcast, Apple Podcast, a lot of the other random Breaker and these others that nobody seems to know about. And that is all. Stay tuned. Thank you so much again.
Thank you.